theory of mesons and nuclear forces and the quantum theory of the electron. Over and over again, the use of formal analogies. This is not all there is to it. We are trying always to feel our way into something new and unexperienced. We take into it what we have, which is our own experience, in this case, of the physical world. And we seek a relevant pattern of form and order. Mathematics plays a part in the expression of this, but it is not essential to it. I mean, the analogy, the notion of analogy, is deeper than the notion of formulae. Not deeper, perhaps, than all parts of mathematics. These analogies are sometimes right and sometimes wrong. Analysis, the confrontation of the full logical consequences of what it is that we've asserted with what we have learned to observe, is the final arbiter of whether the analogy is right and how far it's right. It determines the truth of the conjecture. But without the analogy, there would be no way to go into a new field. You have, in entering novelty, to use what you know. You wouldn't be able to make meaningful mistakes without analogy. You wouldn't be able to try things out, the failure of which was interesting. You start thinking by the use of analogy. Analogy is not the criterion of truth. It is the criterion of creativity and the sign of the effort of human minds to cope with something novel, something fresh, something unexpected. Analogies play in the relation between the sciences a very great part, sometimes a harmful one. And they also play a decisive part in what little there is that natural science can teach of general use in general human experience. One of the great things of this century, and I think for our children it will be better understood, is how illuminating and relevant the experience of the quantum theory of complementarity has been, how wide the scope of those analogies. What do I mean by that? Well, these equations that the uncertainty in the position of an electron can be very small, the uncertainty in its momentum can be very small, the lack of definition this is, but no experiment, no situation can be devised which makes them both very small at the same time. This means that, of course, the physicist or anybody else has some choice as to what he is going to look at in a system and what he's going to realize. Is he going to realize a positioned electron or an electron which has a well-defined velocity and wavelength? He can do one or the other, but they're complementary in the sense that there is no piece of equipment which will do both for him. He cannot realize them both together, and one says that is complementarity. Well, life is full of that, of course. We all know it in the relations between our acts and our introspection, our thinking about our acts. Hamlet has said it better than Planck's constant. We know it in the difference and in the inherent inability fully to combine the ideals of love and the ideals of justice. They are just about two different things. Balance between them, yes, but fulfillment of both simultaneously, I think we know that that's not possible. The difference between a piece of knowledge, a piece of equipment, or a man, regarded on the one hand as an instrument, or on the other hand as an end or a purpose or an object. The difference between the inevitable and universal transience of events and their eternal and timeless quality. This is part of life, and it is simply a rich set of analogies to the rather well-defined, sharply defined, non-ambiguous, straightforward complementarity that one found in the heart of the atom. Well, so it is, I think, also with the electron theory. All of life has both its aspects of being complete in itself and of referring outside itself. Closure and openness are with us all the time. Here in this quite beautiful theory, perhaps one of the most perfect and most accurate and most lovely that man has discovered, we have both external proof, but above all internal proof, that it has only a finite range, that it doesn't describe everything that it pretends to describe. The range is enormous. But internally, the theory is telling us, don't take me absolutely or seriously. I have some relation to a world that you're not talking about when you're talking about me. This is a kind of rebuke, of course, to anyone who believes that any specialty can wholly exhaust life or its meaning. Our knowledge is limited by the limits of our experience. It grows all the time. As we see more of the harmony, the order, and the beauty in the world, we take great pride and joy in that knowledge, and it's the reward of the scientist. The power that comes with it is for other people. But we can be reminded at the same time that we are aware of our knowledge and its scope and its beauty, that built into it, there are also these perceived limitations. I think that is a lesson that Frank Carlson never had to learn, because he was a very modest man.
Thank you, Dr. Oppenheimer. This concludes the first John Franklin Carlson lecture. Thank you.